I'm glad we're still here together. It's been an incredible morning for me. I'm in Pacific Dateline. And looking at all the community members that are across the globe, it just makes us feel so proud right now. Thank you for being here. Let's go with our next speaker, though. I have Ratnesh Madan on the line. Our next speaker is Ratnesh Madan. He's a research software development engineer at Microsoft. His session is titled Microsoft AirSim: Applications to Research and Industry. Before Microsoft, Ratnesh was a master's in robotics student at Carnegie Mellon University, working on perception and motion planning algorithms for quadrotors on the AirLab at the Robotics Institute. He focuses on thing obstacle detection and mapping for UAVs and marrying traditional sampling-based motion planning algorithms with machine learning. All right, Ratnesh, you ready? All right, all yours. Take it away. Thank you. I think we can
Can you
go
hear
ahead.
me? Can you hear me?
Yep, that works. Good
Okay.
job. Yeah, after this, I guess I can do live streams for a living. All right, Ratnesh, it's back to you.
Okay. Thanks, Simone, for the introduction. Hi, everyone. I'm Ratnesh. I'm a research engineer at Microsoft, and I'll be talking about Microsoft AirSim, our open source simulators for drone, cars, and computer vision, and its applications to research and industry. Thanks for the PX4, Aterion, and DroneCode community for hosting me. And thanks everyone for joining from your homes around the world. AirSim came out in the spring of 2017, and recently we actually hit like a cool milestone of 10,000 stars on GitHub. As I said, it's a robotic simulator, and it comes with three modes, one for drones, cars, and computer vision in general. With a bunch of sensors, RGBD, semantic segmentation cameras, LiDAR, and a lot of physics-based sensors, so to speak, like barometer, magnetometer, IMU, and GPS. And it has been used extensively in research and as well as industry till now. Just to give like a quick architectural overview of our simulator. I think like most of the people attending the session would be already aware that the simulator's job is to take in control inputs and give back to you the sensor data. In this right box, we can see like the actuator signals in AirSim. They can come from various sources. They can come from a C++ or a Python API and get routed through a flight controller in HIDL or SITL. Or they can also even come from a manual, like an RC transmitter. And then these actuator signals go through, let's say, an actuator model along with some filtering, and then which basically gives us generated thrust and torque at the range point. And then there's also environment simulation, so you can have like local environment conditions at that actuator, like the air density or the gravity, and using all that, you can calculate like the net external forces and torques acting on the vehicle body along with drag. And then basically, all that is routed to a custom physics engine, which is going to compute the next force or the material, basically kinematics of the body. Now, that kinematics can be applied to a bunch of sensor models, which will, and that's how IMU, GPS, barometer, magnetometer kind of things are implemented. And that sensor data can be accessible on the client side through the API layer, or it can be fed back through the flight controller. And basically, where the rendering engine comes is that like the physics engine, the force predicted by the physics engine, it's gonna be passed. We use that force to move the drone mesh or the drone mesh in Unreal Engine or Unity. And after that, we can get like the camera data or the LiDAR data. And from the API layer, you can basically do your higher level autonomy or reinforcement learning, imitation learning based research, whatever you're interested in. Depending on like what your use case is, I'm just gonna highlight like a couple of use cases here. So on top left, you can see like a custom environment we built for the Rapa Subterranean Challenge. And the winning team actually generated synthetic data using that environment from CMU and OSU. And on top right, you can see a customized wind turbine model in which you can sort of change the speed at which the blades are rotating, as well as the deformation of the mesh. And then on the bottom, I'm just showing how AirSim can be used to essentially simulate like an inspection task pair. Here I'm using the ROS wrapper with a stereo pair. And along with that, I'm basically using VoxBlocks, open source mapping library by ETH Zurich, along with some custom path planning and trajectory following. And here in RWiz, you can basically see like the RGBD point cloud along with the reconstructed occupancy grid map. And now and then you can also see like the sign distance tree. So without further ado, I'm gonna go to the first research project I wanna highlight. So this was a collaboration between ETH Zurich, University of Zurich, Microsoft and Stanford. And we essentially organized a drone racing competition in Europe this year. So the drone racing is a very cool task, which brings, I think, like all the hard problems in autonomy together. So you have to do state estimation, map the gates and avoid the other incoming obstacles, which are essentially like the other competitor drones, and essentially plan a trajectory and follow it optimally in this complicated racetracks. And humans, as you can see on the video on the right side, are able to do this using just like an analog signal from an FPV image from a camera mounted on the drone. And then the inputs are basically body rate and thrust commands. And then, as is the case with a lot of games and tasks which humans are good at these days, there is definitely a research push to figure out how far we can go with autonomy to do a task like this. So depending on what kind of background you're coming from, you can formulate this in a very classical way in which you will do mapping, path planning, trajectory tracking control, and finally figure out the control commands and send them to the flight controller. And of course, there are multiple modules in this case. So you will essentially start with something like state estimation, like visual shared odometry, use that state estimate and computer vision to figure out what the trajectory you want to plan through. Or else you can go completely end-to-end. That's another extreme. You can take like the raw RGB image and basically train a visual model policy, an end-to-end black box, which will spit out the body rate thrust commands. Or you can, I think there's another push right now in which like people are sort of combining the best of the both worlds. So you can learn representations or come up with like traditional policy classes, for example, an RL or imitation algorithm in which you will try to combine both the classical intuitions and the deep learning based way of thinking. So that's kind of like the motivation as to why we organized this competition, because we think like ASM can be a great way to get people to work on this and make rapid progress. And in this competition, we are basically focusing on the top left red box here, planning and computer vision and state estimation and flight control is sort of assumed to be done for you because it's a simulator. So the objective here is basically you have to fly through all the gates in minimum possible time without hitting an opponent drone. And I'll explain what I mean by the opponent drone here. So we broke planning and perception into three tiers in this competition. So in the first tier, which is planning only, you sort of know the ground truth geometry of the environment. You know where the gate poses are, you know the dimensions of the gates, you know where you are and also how you're moving. So you know your own state estimate. And you know the state estimate of the opponent drone as well. And then the second task is sort of a time trial format. In this tier, there is no opponent drone, but the gate noises which are returned from our API, they are corrupted. So you can see like they are still like roughly close to the center of the gate. So if like the next gate is not visible, you can still sort of use that noisy pose estimate to roughly steer towards its direction. But at the end of the day, you will have to detect it, basically figure out how far it's away from you and plan something and fly through it. And then tier 3 is essentially a combination of both the two tiers. So there is noisy gate poses, there's an opening, and then I'm just showing like a couple of race environments from our track, from our competition tiers, and just to give a feel of what it looks like. Some logistics. We ran this competition initially in three phases. So the first phase was a training phase, which ran for about 9 weeks. And we saw quite a lot of enthusiasm across the world from people weighing from mostly academia and also some industry labs and startups, which was followed by a qualification round, which ran for 5 weeks. And then we finally filtered some teams, which competed in the final round. And the training round, you were allowed to modify the racetracks however you want. You can sort of set the gate poses and sizes, but that wasn't allowed in the last two rounds. And just to highlight the challenges again, like the first challenge of this problem is certainly trajectory planning and control. And like the nice, like the very cool thing about this was that, I mean, intuitively, you don't necessarily have to fly through the center of the gate. You can basically pick a point at the gate cross section and come up with an optimal plan. But there was essentially only one team who did that, and they won the first tier. Secondly, there is obstacle avoidance of dynamic obstacles, which is like the other drone here. So this other drone tool was basically sampling a waypoint in the gate cross section randomly and fitting a minimum jerk to shift and slide through it. There's cupboard abstraction and planning. So like you wanna move in a way so that you hopefully maximize the amount of gates you will see after you pass this one. And then you would want to generalize to arbitrary racetracks. We didn't have arbitrary textures in the competition, but like different shapes, sizes, lighting conditions, different environments. So there were like 3-4 environments over which the racetracks were set. And also, of course, there are like always variable number of gates visible in the FPV image. And depending on what level of ASM APIs you are using, you can have a lot of parameters you can tune. So you can go as high as to like trajectory planning and ignore planning and control completely if you want to focus on perception, or you can go lower down the stack up to attitude control for the competition, but in the future, or motor control as well. So this is just sort of highlighting the heat map of the registered teams across the world. There were roughly 115 teams which registered. Out of them, I guess like roughly 12-13% of them submitted. We got 12-13% unique submissions in the qualification round. And after some filtering, we finally had 10 unique submissions in the final round. I've listed the winners in the matrix in the bottom here. And it was really amazing to see like each of the winning teams were like spread across different countries, and they were really enthusiastic and came up with novel approaches. So post the competition, we have been essentially working on improving our framework, and we are calling this ASM Drone Racing Lab. Basically, a suite of extensions to the original ASM simulator and focus on the domain of drone racing. So they are like Unreal Engine level APIs, which essentially let you modify environment objects. And then they are like race APIs, which essentially help you orchestrate drone races. And then finally, they are like a bunch of control APIs from motor level control up to the highest level trajectory planning. And I've added some GIFs on the right side to give a sense of what it looks like. And we are also working on some upcoming features. We definitely want to add different types of gates, give the environment ground truth occupancy, and then also along with that, sign distance fields, which can be used in optimization-based planners, and finally, event-based cameras, which are becoming more and more important every year in our field because of their high frame rate and asynchronicity. So most of our work is available in these two GitHub repos. We basically released ASM Drone Racing Lab last week. which is like a cleaned up version of the repository of the Game of Thrones repository, which is listed below that. And there is, for more details, there is like an archive preprint available here, which was accepted in the PMLR proceedings for the competition track. Now I'm gonna move to the second half of the talk. And this is a research project we did with collaboration from Rogerio Banati, a PhD student from CMU, and my previous advisor, Sebastian Scherer, and Vibhav from MSR. So here the premise is that like we want to focus on learning visual representations, which will help us effect a sim-to-real transfer of flight control policies. Specifically in this case, like we agree that ASIM is a first photorealistic simulator, but still there is a lot of effort involved in recreating a test, like an actual realistic scenario, especially if you want to fly something in the real world. So the approach here is that, or the intuition here is that if we can sort of learn to extract features from the image which we think intuitively are meaningful or meaningful for the task, and hopefully those features will sort of abstract away any of the useless or any of the domain gap between sim and real, between simulation and reality. So in our particular case, we think like the visual information along with the relative gate pose of the gate, the relative pose of the gate from the drone is important. So this is what it's going to look at test time. You take an RGB image, you extract some latent space from it, you pass that latent space to a policy network, which essentially gives out a velocity command, which is passed through the flight controller. But at train time, what happens is like the way this VA is trained is you have two reconstruction losses, one for the image itself, and the other one is basically the relative pose of the gate. And then the policy loss is coming from essentially behavior cloning. So this is like the most basic imitation learning algorithm, and the expert planner is essentially coming from a Moore's Flying API. So we basically generate a lot of randomized racetracks in the sim, log the commanded velocity commands used by Moveon Spline to track that trajectory, and then essentially regress to those commands given the latent space. And this is just like a quick representation of what the latent space, the interpolation of the latent space. So we can actually constrain some of the latent variables to be meaningful, and by meaningful I mean specifically the relative spherical coordinates, for example here. So here you can see from this image to this image, we are sort of changing Z0 or R, which is mapping to R, and this gate is sort of moving inside and outside the image. Similarly for relative roll pitch in here. And these are like the visual, other visual features. This little graphic is showing how we generated the training data. So here you can see Moveon Spline in action. What's really happening is like every time I pass like gate N, I move gate N minus one to a random pose, so that like the training data set is still similar, but it's seeing different relative gates at every given time, and you sort of log out the commanded velocity commands. And then I'll quickly show some more real-world results. So this paper was accepted at IRIS 2020. It's also available on archive. I think I have already talked about some of the things happening here. But here's like a top-down view of testing site at CMU, essentially. And you can see these gates are quite professionally engineered. They have like swimming pool noodles and PVC pipes. And then we also tested them. We also ran the policy in some adversarial conditions, which is Pittsburgh most of the days of the year, heavy wind and snowfall. And then just to clarify things again, I think this is how the VA is trained. Your input image is RGB. You're sort of reconstructing. You have two losses, the image reconstruction loss as well as the relative Git post at training time, but at test time you basically just forward pass through the encoder. This is something I wanted to sort of highlight. So these are like images from the real world, input image A and B. So this is A, these are like, and then you're sort of interpolating the latent space vector between these two. So you can kind of see how this is interesting. It's really mapping approximately to the same pose and similar background variations along with the horizon line. And it's roughly changing smoothly across the latent space. And of course, we had some baselines. So from left to right, it's like increasing track difficulty in simulation. And then we can see, and then there's like an end-to-end baseline, which is basically training a sensory motor policy without any VAE or without learning any representation. And the last one is without the relative gait pose geometric loss. I probably skipped this in the interest of time. So yeah, this is like a nice visualization of the FPV image, the decoded image, and the decoded gait pose. So this is where the policy or the representation thinks the drone is. And here's another visualization of the real image, the decoded image, which is similar to the simulation domain. Looks like the ASM image. And then on the left, we are basically accumulating the predicted gait pose. Of course, there's some error, but it's like roughly matching the real racing track. And some more results in the same swimming pool. So the code is available at this GitHub repo, ASM drone racing VAE imitation. And you can also check out the paper for more details. Lastly, I want to highlight another project from pretty much ALR at CMU and Ashish at MSR. I'm not an author here, but basically they were using AirSim to generate So they basically collect a lot of varying environments in their lighting conditions, indoors, outdoors, for generating a data set for state estimation and like other autonomy tasks. And essentially what's happening is we are currently running a SLAM challenge based on this data set at a CVPR workshop. So you can follow this link for more details, or this GitHub repo for more details. And you can see there are like very varying conditions. And this data set in general comes with stereo images, disparity, segmentation map, along with LiDAR data, optical flow, and occupancy grids. So what I wanted to highlight here is that, like, if you open up their paper, they made some comparisons with the Kiri data set as to how aggressive and diverse the motion is. Because like in aerial vehicles, usually the state estimation problem tends to be much more harder. And they also compare it with the Yurok map data set as well. And the way the synthetic trajectories are generated here is like you use the LiDAR sensor in AirSim, construct an occupancy map, then basically construct a roadmap from that in the free space, and then sample that roadmap to generate random parts. Once you have those random parts, you can again sort of generate SK3 like full trajectories and full poses, and basically make them easy, medium, or hard, however, whatever is your preference. Okay, so yeah, those were the 3-4 projects I wanted to highlight, and I'm happy to take questions at this point.
Thank you, Ratnesh. Can you hear me okay? Awesome. Can you do me a quick favor and stop sharing your screen?
Yep.
All right. So we're running out of time, but I'm going to cheat and give you 2 questions. Can we run AirSim in headless mode like Gazebo?
Yes, we can. I think it's documented in the GitHub repo.
Excellent. Good to know. There's one last question. What types of flying vehicles are supported by AirSim?
What types of flying vehicles are supported by AirSim?
Yeah.
So, yeah, right now, I mean, we are like the, you can actually simulate any kind of multi-rotor you want, but it's relatively hard to do so, and we are working to make that easier. Out of the box, we
All right, that's I think you're back. Let's do this right now. So why don't you join us on the PX4 Slack and the PX4 Dev Summit channel? Yeah. There's at least 6 or 7 other questions from the community that are really cool. Why don't we try to do an interactive session there live if you're still available?
Yep, I can do that.
Sounds good. All right, thank you for your time, Ratnesh. I'm going to hang up now and go to my live view. Thank you.
All right.